Welcome. My name is Glenn Michaelchuk, and I'm chair of Peace Alliance Winnipeg. This is the second in a series of webinars on Canada's role in the world. The need for a series like this to examine Canada's role in the world arose from the Peace Alliance Winnipeg's annual general meeting, and the realization that this topic needs thorough examination as part of building public opinion to affect the changes needed in Canada's actions abroad, and particularly its foreign policy that more often than not supports actions which are detrimental to the sovereignty and rights of other nations and peoples. Our second webinar deals with Canada's war making. Over the past century, Canada has been among the most warlike nations, from Sudan and South Africa in the late 1800s, to Korea in the 1950s, to Libya and Afghanistan more recently. And also Canada has played a role in actively pursuing regime change in countries such as Venezuela, and of course actually doing that in a country in Haiti. More recently, Canada has amped up its NATO role with Canadian troops in Latvia, Ukraine, and Iraq, as well as Canadian naval vessels in the Black Sea and South China Sea. With us today is Yves Engler. Yves has been dubbed by Briar Patch magazine as one of the most important voices on the left. He has published 9 books, many of which deal specifically with the subject of today's webinar. So welcome, Yves, and please begin.
Thanks, thanks, Glenn, and thanks everyone for participating and the Winnipeg Peace Alliance for putting this on. I just want to start by acknowledging that I'm speaking to you from traditional Indigenous territory, the Jodjage, which has long been a point of meeting and exchange among many First Nations. So what I thought that I would do is just begin with a little brief kind of sketching out of the scope of the Canadian military. The Canadian military is far and away the largest federal government department. There's about 70,000 active soldiers, 30,000 reservists, and 25,000 DND employees. Its budget is about $24 billion. That doesn't include Veterans Affairs, which has a budget of about a bit more than $5 billion, and it itself has about 4,000 employees. And there's a number of other elements to the Canadian government that you could argue are sort of part of the military. So the full budget is into the $30 billion range, depending exactly how you quantify it. Veteran Affairs budget is more than twice the size of Environment Canada's budget, Environment and Climate Change Canada. DND's budget is more than 10 times the size of Environment and Climate Change Canada's budget, and about 4 times the size of Foreign Affairs and the former CETA, the aid agency, Global Affairs Canada. There's one office with Pentagon of the North in Ottawa that has 8,500 employees, D&D building. It's has 11 interconnected buildings on 2 million square feet of building space. That's just the biggest office of the D&D. They have many dozens more in Ottawa, and then all across the country, they operate 20,000 buildings. It's the largest infrastructure portfolio in the federal government. D&D operates the largest infrastructure portfolio in the federal government. 20,000 buildings, 5,500 kilometers of roads, 3,000 kilometers of waterworks. Its bases and stations across the country are over 2 million hectares, which is about half the land mass of Switzerland. So this is, you know, it's an immense institution. The Navy has about 50 frigates, submarines, and other vessels. Air Force has about 400 aircraft. The Army has tens of thousands of land vehicles. It has the only federally funded degree-granting university, so the Royal Military College of Canada at Kingston. It has, D&D operates 24 different specialized educational facilities, things like the Canadian Forces School of Meteorology or the Royal Canadian Electrical and Mechanical Engineering School. D&D and the Canadian Forces operate the largest public relations entity in the country. Hundreds, different estimates. One had it at over 650 full-time employees working in public relations for the Canadian Forces or D&D. They have by far, D&D has by far the largest intelligence gathering apparatus of the federal government, because both the Canadian Forces have their own intelligence gathering, a couple thousand employees in intelligence or soldiers in intelligence. And then they also, the Communications Security Establishment, which is about, I think, 2,100, 2,200 employees, it also falls under the D&D, under the Ministry of the Department of National Defense. So this is, you know, the more you look into the military, just you understand just the incredible scope of the institution. It's an incredible proportion of Canadian government operations. The Canadian military's roots are British, of course. They, you know, the force that suppressed First Nations, be it in the Atlantic, be it in, you know, gunboat diplomacy and what's now Vancouver Island and the coastal area of British Columbia. And after Confederation, of course, that force helped in the suppression of the Métis and Indigenous peoples on the prairies. In 1876, the Canadian government set up the Royal Military College in Kingston, Ontario. And the objective was to, part of the objective was to train officers for the Canadian, military to, you know, suppress Indigenous people. But the other part was about what one author called creating proper white gentlemen to be officers of British imperialism. So there were dozens, probably hundreds of Royal Military College graduates in the late 1800s and early 1900s that helped the British conquer different parts of Africa, all across West Africa. Actually one prominent one helped the Belgian king conquer a big chunk of the Congo for King Leopold II. Canada has been involved in many wars. Canadian forces have been involved in many wars. Probably the first one that is little known of is the 385 Canadians that were dispatched to help the British maintain control of Khartoum. In the current day Sudan, the British forces were besieged, British forces that controlled the city were besieged by indigenous Sudanese, and they, about almost 400 Canadians were dispatched to help the British maintain control of Khartoum. Ultimately, it was a failure, and actually Canadians, Royal Military College trained Canadians would help the British reconquer Khartoum about a decade later. In 1899 began 7,000 Canadians that would fight in the so-called Boer War that would leave about 20,000, more than 20,000 Boer women and children were killed in concentration camps that the British set up. A similar number of Black Africans were killed, but they didn't actually keep count. So we're not exactly sure how many Africans were killed in these concentration camps. And really what the Boer War was about British mining interests, but also about London being worried that the Boer states were consolidating, and that the center of economic control would move outside of their colonies, and South Africa was an important geostrategic position with regards to India and other British colonies in Africa. So 7,000 Canadians were dispatched to fight in that war that lasted about 3 years. In World War I, about 400,000 Canadians fought, a bit more than 400,000 Canadians fought in World War I. About 60,000 were killed. 150,000 or so came back wounded, often seriously so. World War I was just a complete madness of imperial real nonsense. I mean, from a human perspective, there was just huge numbers killed for 20 feet of land or a couple hundred meters of territory in Western Europe. It was really quite a level of destruction and stupidity that's hard to wrap one's head around. Canada during World War I was directly involved in maintaining British colonialism. So, for instance, there were Canadians that garrisoned in different British colonies in the Caribbean, garrisoned those colonies. And there was also Canadians who helped conquer different parts of West and East Africa for the British territories that the Germans had been controlling, Tanzania. Cameroon, what's now Cameroon in West Africa. And World War II, I'll get to this later, probably the only ultimately justifiable war that Canada's participated in. About 1 million Canadians fought in World War II, a bit more than 1 million. But Canadians, reinforced British colonialism in Africa, in Asia, in Burma, different parts, Hong Kong, considered one of the biggest military disasters in Canadian history is the Canadians that were dispatched to maintain control of Hong Kong for the British, who got about almost half of them, I think, were killed. And all of them basically got captured and had a very terrible treatment. Again, during World War II, Canadian troops garrisoned Jamaica and other British colonies in the Caribbean. In World War II, sort of begins the process where Canada really goes from the Canadian military as well, goes from a arm of British military power to being an arm of American military power. The first step in that, or the most important step in that, is the Korean War of 1950-1953, where about 27,000 Canadian troops fight. Many Canadian naval vessels, I believe it was about a dozen Canadian naval vessels. And that's a war that's just, the level of horror is just kind of beyond belief. At one point, the Americans stopped bombing North Vietnam because all buildings of more than one story had been destroyed. Estimates go as high as 4 million people killed. And that war was really motivated by the Mao's forces winning control of China, uniting China the year before, 1949. A combination of a fear of communism, but I think as much a fear of Chinese nationalism. And also basically just military Keynesianism and having a justification for restarting the war economy, that after World War II, there'd been economic downturn and needing a justification for ramping up military spending, both in the US, primarily in the US, but also in Canada. And it also is part, it legitimated dispatching, returning many tens of thousands of Canadian and American troops to Western Europe and basically reinforcing NATO. Sort of bizarrely that what was going on in Korea was ended up being the justification for that. But the idea was is that it was the Soviets that were behind what was going on in Korea, and so the Soviets are threatening, and so we have to not only send huge numbers of troops to Korea, but we also need to send troops to Western Europe to stop the Soviet menace in Western Europe. That was at least the justification. It's tied into the creation of NATO, which was in 1949. Fast forward to the early 90s, and 4,000 Canadian soldiers participate in the war, first war in Iraq. Mark Curtis described as, quote, the open rehabilitation of colonialism and imperialism. Huge numbers of Iraqi soldiers and those who were even fleeing Kuwait, leaving Kuwait after the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait, and also Iraqi civilians, and Iraqi infrastructure was just destroyed in this war, and there was Canadian government was fine with not pursuing diplomatic means of resolving the conflict, and was quite gung-ho about Washington's push for military conflict, which helped destroy Iraq's infrastructure and really returned Iraq back decades, and is an important part. And when we look at the Middle East today and we look at Iraq today, the first Iraq war is really important in setting the stage to the just kind of incredible destruction that we've seen there over the past few decades. In the late 1990s, 18 Canadian fighter jets dropped 530 bombs on the former Yugoslavia, Serbia, and the justification, of course, was to protect civilians, Kosovars, but in fact, they greatly increased the level of exodus and also of violence on the ground, and the motivation really was about, one, justifying NATO, two, there had been a broader policy of dividing the former Yugoslavia, and that was tied to pushing a sort of neoliberal privatization kind of economic policy. And American officials have been fairly open about that in their explanations of the war subsequently. In the early 2000s, or for about a decade through the 2000s, there was 40,000 Canadian troops that were dispatched to Afghanistan, that occupied, that fought in Afghanistan. What that was all about, I've still never, to be honest with you, fully understand what the war in Afghanistan was about beyond just militarism for the sake of militarism. There was a claim that it was tied to 9/11, the bombing in the U.S., but the attacks in the U.S. But if you look at the situation today, you find that there's the Al Qaeda looks better than the ISIS forces that are now operating there, and obviously the Taliban has control over most of the country, and we don't know how many people Canadian troops killed, but it was certainly into the thousands in a direct sense. There's lots of different reports that boasting by Canadian officials of just how many enemies that Canadian forces killed, sniper fire, calling it American bombing, et cetera. Clearly, hundreds of thousands, almost certainly, of Afghans were killed directly and indirectly by the foreign forces. In 2011, a Canadian general oversaw the bombing of Libya, There were a half dozen Canadian fighter jets, a couple Canadian patrol vessels, naval vessels that patrolled and launched missiles into destroyed vessels of the government, of the Gaddafi government. The war in Libya, I think, is explained by a variety of factors. Gaddafi had never been, while he had gone kind of back and forth, he had never been the preferred leader for Washington and Ottawa. He had moved in a direction around oil that was viewed as not totally favorable to foreign oil companies. And Gaddafi had pushed certain elements of a Pan-African policy. And that's actually why the African Union, part of why the African Union was vehemently opposed to the NATO war in Libya. And they stated really clearly and repeatedly that this war is gonna, what's gonna be the result? What's gonna happen in terms of where's the weapons, where are the weaponry gonna go? What's gonna happen in terms of destabilization? And Canadian US officials completely ignored the repeated efforts by the African Union to negotiate a peaceful solution to the conflict early on, and actually for a couple months through the bombing campaign. And of course the African Union was completely correct. The war in Libya spilled into Mali pretty quickly, and that then later became why Canadian so-called peacekeepers were sent to Mali, but also it spilled all across the Sahel region, exacerbating problems with Boko Haram in Nigeria and also with Al-Shabaab in Somalia, and you have like Canadian officials. David Puglesi reported on this in Ottawa Citizen. Canadian officials were fighter pilots were joking about how they were Al-Qaeda's air force during the bombing of Libya. This was reported on in the Ottawa Citizen, but you know, never gets sort of mentioned afterwards. And Canadian government had internal assessments that the likely result of the bombing campaign. I should also mention there were almost certainly Canadian special forces on the ground in Libya as well, explicitly against the UN resolutions. They knew that it was going to likely lead to a rise of sort of hardline jihadist kind of forces. And of course, Libya, things look like they're getting a little bit better now in the last handful of months, but the country's been divided basically in civil war, more or less since the 2011 NATO assault. So over the past century or so, Canada's been involved, depending on how you define it, but I listed out 9 different wars. Only one of those wars can you make a case that it was morally justifiable, and that's World War II. Now, there was lots that happened around World War II that, first of all, in the fighting of how World War II took place, that was completely immoral. The bombing of Germany, Canada's role in trying to reassert British colonialism in different parts. There's also all kinds of things that Canada did before World War II and other countries that put us down the path to war that they shouldn't have pursued. And you know, obvious things like the basically supporting Franco's forces in Spain during the civil war there, and also their relationship to Hitler and how, you know, Mackenzie King was very close. Canadian Prime Minister was quite, or close is too strong, but he was quite sympathetic to Hitler. But once you were, and also with regards to efforts by the Soviet Union to have an alliance to stop German expansionism. But once you were where you were in 39, 40, 1940, then I think that ultimately, going to war was justifiable. But Canada's motivation for going to war was not to fight anti-Semitism, to fight fascism. It was to support the British Empire at the point where, you know, Nazi Germany had become a threat to the British Empire, and that was the motivation for Canada joining World War II, not some sort of, you know, defense of democracy or whatnot. Today, Canada's not really at war, sort of in Iraq, Syria, kind of depending on at different points in recent years, but not formally at war or how it's sort of perceived. Yet the Canadian military is involved in a couple dozen international missions, right? Most of them are really small. Some of them quite political, like in the West Bank, right? You have about 23 Canadian troops that are basically creating under the U.S. Special Coordinator, building up a Palestinian security force to suppress protests against Israel's expansionism, right? That's what the Operation Proteus that Canada is involved with in the West Bank. So that's a very political question. But other ones are, you know, slightly less so. But a couple of them are quite big, right? In Latvia, you have over 500 Canadian troops in Latvia heading up a NATO mission right on the border with Russia, exacerbating tensions with Russia. You have a couple hundred Canadian troops in the Ukraine, similar kind of dynamic, often supporting these, you know, far right forces in the Ukraine. And then you also have Iraq, where there have been, you know, two main Canadian military missions, the special forces, a couple hundred Canadian special forces on the ground, and then also the Canadian training mission. Now, the special forces at different points have just tried to frame it as a training mission, but then simultaneously they boast about how Canadian special forces killed somebody at, I think it was 3.4 kilometers, apparently the longest ever sniper shot in, you know, human history. So on one hand, it's a training mission. On the other hand, we want to boast about our great military exploits. Additionally, if you people have probably seen in recent days, in a couple of recent weeks, there's these reports, just horrible. These Canadian forces who are training Iraqi troops, who the Iraqis were showing them video of these like horrors, these rapes, these like hanging people from a lamppost. Showing the Canadian troops these images on their, I guess, on their phones, a video of it, and some of them, fortunately, there were some of the Canadian troops that were horrified by this and basically brought it up to the chain of command. And what did the chain of command do was they basically just tried to suppress the whole thing, didn't stop the training going on. And then it was only because when some of the Canadian troops returned, they pushed the issue that it actually got any attention, and finally got into the media. But what is the mission in Iraq about? I think in large part at this point it's about countering Iranian influence within Iraq, which, you know, may, you can debate whether that's the greatest thing or not, but I don't think it's Canada's role halfway across the world to, you know, send troops to a country that's been, you know, pulverized by U.S. Other country militarism in recent decades, and try to combat a bordering nation's influence. Likewise, you have Canadian naval vessels all across the world, right? You have Canadian naval vessels running provocative maneuvers in the South China Sea, into the Black Sea, North Sea, in the Mediterranean, around the Persian Gulf, and, you know, Canadian naval vessels are basically positioned around the world, kind of constantly. At all times, covering different parts of different regions of the world, kind of almost at all times, and it's just one sign of the sort of forward nature of Canadian foreign policy. Now, I don't know how much time I have. I was planning on going through, trying to go quickly through a country, Canada's military relationship to a country where we've never been at war, but yet we've had an incredible amount of military involvement. That's Haiti. And I thought I'd do that because I'm just writing a story about this, and because Haiti's kind of in the news and there's a lot of people concerned about the fact that the US military may intervene in Haiti, and there's actually some indication that there are already American troops landed at Port-au-Prince airport in the last couple of days. And so in February of 2019, Canadian Special Forces were videoed in the Port-au-Prince airport by the Haiti Information Project during a general strike against Jovenel Moïse, who was recently assassinated. After the earthquake in 2010, Canada sent 2,000 troops to basically, we didn't send heavy urban search and rescue teams. We sent 2,000 troops, and we have the internal government document stating this explicitly, because we were concerned of a power vacuum that would lead to possibly Jean-Bertrand Aristide, the president that we helped overthrow 6 years earlier, returning from exile in South Africa. In 2004, Canadian Special Forces were on the ground the night where Aristide, controlling the airport, the Port-au-Prince airport, the night that Aristide says he was kidnapped by US Marines and dumped in the Central African Republic. There were more than 500 Canadian troops on the ground in Haiti for the next 6 months or so, and there's reports of them being involved in different repression of the Lavalas, those who were supportive of Aristide. And there were Canadian troops in part of the MINUSTAH, the UN mission, through the high officials, including the chief of staff at one point, through the UN mission, basically the whole time from 2004 to 2017. If you go back earlier, after the US invaded in 1994, and that's a complicated question of the good or badness of that invasion. It's more complicated than most US invasions, but nonetheless, there were 750 Canadian troops in Haiti and Canada headed the UN mission that took over from the US military mission. In the book, Canadian Gunboat Diplomacy, which I believe came out in 2000, they report on a number of Canadian naval vessels being dispatched to Haiti in 1988, 1987, 1974, 1963, 1964. In the early 60s, those vessels were dispatched alongside US and French vessels, basically out of fear that the instability around François Papadoc, Papadoc, his instability around his regime, opposition to his regime, would lead to a Cuban style revolution, or Cuban inspired kind of revolutionary forces would take advantage of the instability. So Canada has set naval vessels to pressure and influence Haitian politics repeatedly. If you go back even historically, in 1865, a British frigate, HMS Galetta, bombed Cap-Haïtien, the second city. And that was a naval vessel that was based in part in Halifax. And if you go back even before that, the whole Halifax squadron was dispatched to Saint-Domingue, what was previously Haiti, the colony, the French colony, during the Haitian Revolution, right? So the British tried to suppress the Haitian Revolution, and John Graves Simcoe, who has the, lauded in Ontario, he actually controlled part of the Saint-Domingue during the British rule and reimposed slavery, and a number of other prominent Canadians went to suppress the Haitian Revolution. So here is a country where we've never been at war with that country technically, but the Canadian military has been heavily involved and has had a heavy influence over Haitian affairs, overwhelmingly for the negative. So I'm trying to just get back to today. There was a very good article in The Breach a week or 10 days ago, Martin Lucas published about Canada's setting up bases around the world. And there was about a decade ago, 2011, 2010, 2012, I forget what year, there was a couple stories in the corporate media about it at the time, about Canada's plans to set up seven hubs, small bases in different parts of the world, kind of all around the world geographically. And the Breach article really updates that and gives a bunch of detail that I really suggest people take a look at. And it begins by saying the Canadian military has spent the past 10 years establishing a global network of bases in order to project combat power under the influence and leadership of the United States. And the story shows how these American military people were part of choosing the bases or the whole process of establishing the bases. Three of them have been set up: Kuwait, Senegal, and Jamaica, and then a couple of others are still in negotiation. And this all leads to this sort of forward, right? The Canadian government's open about having a forward military policy, right? We got to be engaged military abroad to protect ourselves at home, is the logic with how they sort of try to frame it. And they're resourcing it, right? Right now we have a situation where they're buying fighter jets. $19 billion is a sticker price. The life cycle is probably going to be in the range of $77 billion. Simultaneously, they're buying naval vessels that are expected to cost something in the range of $77 billion sticker price, $286 billion over the life cycle. They're fitted with these Tomahawk missiles. They have the radars, really advanced radars that allows for U.S. officials, U.S. military officials to direct, to just, you know, bomb away from the Canadian naval vessel. So the Canadian government, you know, one hand, it's building bases around the world. It has bases around the world and expanding that. Another, simultaneously, it's building up its fighter jet fleet, its naval fleet, with the intent of fighting in U.S. and NATO-led wars. There's no other reason to be making these, to be building the bases, to be buying the fighter jets, the naval vessels. I think that most Canadians are not actually on board with this, right? Even at a time right now where the anti-war movement, I don't think is that strong, though I think maybe it's gotten a bit stronger in the last year or last couple of years than it's at an even more of a lull. But even at a time when the anti-war movement's not that strong, the public is not that on board with it. It's interesting, the public opinion on these issues, the public is generally quite sympathetic, polls show, to the Canadian military, to the Canadian forces. But when you ask them where their priority is in terms of government spending, the military is consistently at the bottom, right? You give a list of, you know, should it be the economy? Should it be healthcare? Should it be daycare? Whatever, the environment, the military consistently will end up at the bottom of, you know, where funding should go and what their, you know, primary concern is around, you know, political affairs. So there's a lot of sympathy for the institution, little appetite for funding the institution. That's not surprising considering the incredible ideological apparatus of the Canadian military. Simultaneously, public polls generally show that what the military wants to do is the lowest priority of what the public wants from the military, right? So the military wants to fight in NATO and US-led wars, but the public wants disaster relief, peacekeeping. Now that's a complicated question. We can get into what that means. But the public doesn't want this sort of, you know, belligerent, what they perceive as belligerent military force. They want it to be, you know, defend Canada, not for offensive affairs. So there's a lot in terms of public opinion as it is currently, let alone, you know, by mobilizing we can change that opinion at some level, just as it is currently, there's a lot to work with for anti-war forces. There's a lot that places that we can leverage. Obviously, this is a matter of organizing. This is a matter of campaigning. This is a matter of, you know, building social movements. You know, all that hard work. But I think that there's a lot to work with on in terms of public attitude currently. And ultimately, what we need to be pushing for is, you know, defunding the military, right? Is it, you know, I've suggested different points, you know, cutting its budget by 10% for at least 5 years, and then looking at it. I mean, I think there's all kinds of totally fascinating ways you can, you know, go at this. One thing is, you know, these military bases all around the world, all around the country, are littered with ordnance of rockets that were fired, and it totally destroyed landscape. Well, that needs to be cleaned up. Well, can we retrain some of those soldiers to do that work of cleaning up the bases of the, and then as part of a process of land back, right? Let's give that land back, you know, 500, I guess, kilometers of it a year, have some numbers in my book, but, you know, each year to Indigenous, to First Nations, right? So you can process of getting the people who are currently soldiers, retraining them for a process of, you know, a reconciliation process and land back process, you know, genuine reconciliation, through giving up chunks of the Canadian military. And the Canadian military has so much land that you can give up just incredible amounts of it, and they'd still have huge amounts of land. And of course, a lot of these bases were stolen. The land was directly stolen by the military from Indigenous communities. So you know, we need to put on the agenda, and there's a number of countries around the world that don't have militaries. We need to put these kind of questions on the agenda, things like Canada out of NATO, some of the, you know, defunding the military, that needs to be put on the agenda. It's far, you know, right now in the official politics, it's, you know, far from where official politics is at. But I think that there's actually a lot more sympathy for some of these positions already among the public than we might realize. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you, Yves. We'll now proceed to questions, comments from those who are attending. And yes, just raise your hand and we will try and recognize you. Paul will also keep track. I saw Corey. Did you have your hand raised?
Glenn, no, I'll not right now. That was actually an applause.
Okay. Now I see Rachel. I recognize Rachel if you have a comment or question.
Thank you. Yes, that was an amazing amount of information in a short period of time, Eve. Thank you for that. I have two questions. One is, as you know, I'm very involved in the No Fighter Jets campaign. I'm finding it very easy to convince the average person, even people who are not anti-war, that Canada doesn't need to buy 88 new bomber planes. But trying to convince people that Canada should leave NATO seems to be a whole other ballgame. I'm curious if you have any thoughts or strategies on why that is, or how we can sort of unpack that, make that something that is palatable to the public, make it not seem like sort of a Trumpian move away from internationalism, which seems to be how people receive it incredibly. Number one. My second question is, if you have a sense of the relationship between, I guess, military decision-making in Canada, is it that the military comes up with its plans and the government rubber stamps it, or is it more nuanced than that? I feel embarrassed to admit that I have genuinely no sense of who is sort of calling the shots on the Canadian military's expansionist plans, as you described. Thank you.
Yeah, I think the first part, the second question, I think is, I think that the military is calling the shots and the government rubber stamps. And the military is calling the shots mostly in alliance with the U.S. military. And it's, you know, there's just so many different agreements, relationships between the Canadian military and the U.S. military. And they're just, you know, sort of working it out among each other. And then that gets, you know, confirmed by, obviously, once it gets up to the complete, at the most top level of like a full-scale war, then you have, you know, situations where you know, like what the Liberals did around Syria and Iraq was a kind of you know, we're against the bombing campaign because we know that there's lots of Canadians that are uncomfortable with this bombing campaign, but we're going to expand the special forces part of that. And that's, I think, just basically like, they're trying to have both sides, trying to, you know, there's the Canadian public element, and then there's the, we want to make sure the military is not unhappy with us and the relationship with the U.S. military and our relationship with the U.S. But I mean, I think that even if you look at the, the, you know, the patriarchy and sexual assault scandals that are going on, the government just seems so tentative about this. Is, you know, now become quite a massive PR problem, and they're still so tentative about you know, intervening within the military and, you know, and directing things. Now, with regards to NATO, that's an interesting, I think that is how to convince the public around NATO. I mean, part of the answer to that is, you know, like even someone like Linda McQuaig has written basically what you're saying about like that Canada was trying to get the Americans to join NATO because we're concerned that the U.S. was going to be isolationist, first of all, it's completely untrue, right? It's not based upon the history of it, but it's also like, okay, well, if the U.S. wants to be isolationist by not being part of NATO, I'm supportive of U.S. isolationism, right? So there is like a confusion about what, you know, what NATO is. But I think there is also simultaneously, I mean, there were these battles within within the NDP and the you know, CCF, the predecessor of NDP, for decades at that was the number one debate at conventions for like a couple decades. And they finally got the convention to agree in 1969 for a Canada to NATO position. And that was basically on the books within the NDP until 1987. And that was during the Cold War. I mean, so like that, if it seems to me that with the argument that, you know, what's the justification for after the Cold War? But I think, if you look at the NDP's position around Russia and everything to do with Eastern Europe, and even the Greens for that matter, there is basically a consensus in official politics that Canada should be this belligerent NATO force on the border of Russia. So the demonization of Russia is so great that exists. But no, I don't have any, it's certainly a question I probably do more thinking on, but I don't have any particular insight on the, you know, what we need to, how to convince people around NATO.
Next question is, or comment is from Radhika Desai.
I think Nino was before me.
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't see that. Nino, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Wow, this is it's a brilliant presentation. Thanks, Yves, as usual. My question is related to the military spending, which is a great topic for a campaign, as you were mentioning, about defunding the military. But also I think it has to be connected to the weapon industry that Canada has, and that connection has to be made, and I would like to hear about that. But further than that, I think the other connection is to the overall foreign policy, Canadian foreign policy. There's a strict link, connection between the military industry military and Canadian warfare and Canadian foreign policy. I would like to hear maybe some comments about that too. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I think that clearly Canadian military policy is a central part of Canada's imperial policy. And you know, we are sending troops to Haiti repeatedly to basically keep Haiti in this insanely subjugated position within global imperialism. I mean, to put it simply, and racist hierarchies. And so the military its military policy is, you know, very much that. I've written a bit about, you know, to get it really into sort of one-to-one areas, and I think it's mostly happening at a macro level, but, you know, Canada's military policy and its mining, right? You know, like in the 70s and early 80s, the Canadian military was training in Jamaica, pursuing these training plans. And there was a left-wing newspaper in Jamaica called Abang that basically said they're planning to invade to take Alcan's bauxite. And they were, you know, laughed at as, you know, crazy, whatever. Well, Sean Maloney, this right-wing, hard right-wing military historian, got the internal documents to show the Canadian military was planning an invasion of Jamaica in case of a socialist government taking control of Alcan's bauxite interest. And so there's a lot of, I think that, you know, parts of Canadian military policy in you know, Mali, the reason for sending troops to Mali was partly tied to mining policy. So there's other of those sort of, you know, kind of direct examples. So yes, it's definitely part of Canada's position. Canada has been had the Canadian ruling class have had a uniquely privileged relationship to the two greatest empires of the past couple hundred years, right? The British and the Americans. And Canada's military has been, I mean, it was the British military, right? The base in Esquimalt was a British military base. The Canadian Navy was just basically the British military just gave the vessels, and then now we call it the Canadian Navy, right? That's the history of it. And Air Force is kind of similar like that, and then, you know, with World War II, the Canadian military has just transitioned to this, you know, unique relation. No other country's military has a relationship with the US military, right? The level of access that the Canadian military gets, you know, can the Canadian general who was in charge of 35,000 troops in Iraq in 2006, 2007, right? Canada wasn't part of that war. I've joked about how, you know, if the US was to invade Canada, there would be, you know, a huge amount of Canadian military involvement in that invasion, because the Canadian military is so integrated into the US military that they wouldn't be possible for the US military not invade without Canadian soldiers helping out in all kinds of, you know, stages of that. So there's no doubt, and you know, Canadian broader foreign policy, I mean, that's a huge discussion that has so many different elements to it, but certainly it's about advancing corporate interests. That's a central part of it, and you know, there's obviously a racist element to it. There's, you know, and then the other part to this foreign policy you're kind of talking about with the arms industry, Canada's has a significant arms industry, exports. We don't know exactly how significant, partly because we don't know exactly how many weapon sales there are to the U.S. because there's a special agreement that goes back, I guess, almost 70 years now, that the U.S. arms market and the Canadian arms market are treated basically as one and the same. And the Americans were... I'm talking about the defense production sharing arrangement. They did this partly politically, so to allow Canadian arms companies to have access to the U.S. to sell to the U.S. They did it partly to tie the Canadian defense industry or arms industry into being a lobbyist for American foreign policy. Right, to bring it, tie it into being, to be special access to sell to the Pentagon as part of tying it to U.S. foreign policy, and it was very good for Canadian arms companies. It was quite, you know, highly profitable, lots of money made, and it was successful, I think, at the political level as well, and Canadian arms industry is this you know huge a force. It's high tech. It's you know provides some you know well paid jobs. It's been you know the computers in Canada was because of defense spending and these you know public money going to private arms manufacturing companies that were you know doing high tech development. So you know it's immoral. I don't think you know some of these questions. I think at an economic level, I don't think it's quite as wrong morally speaking, yes, but I think that there's some it's not a, there's logic to some of this military spending from the standpoint of technological development, whatever. Obviously there's other ways we could and should be doing that, but within the capitalist power structure, it's actually I think often quite logical economic policy.
Okay, Radhika, you're next, please.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for a great presentation, Yves. Really, all your decades of expertise on this really shows, and I really appreciate that. Couple of questions. One is, you know, given how long you've been involved in this and how long you've campaigned for the causes, and you mentioned two in particular, which is, you know, we would all agree are very key goals to pursue, which is, you know, defund the military, including land back, et cetera, but also get out of NATO. So in your view, given how your experience of trying to get particularly the NDP, but generally political parties to come on board, what are the biggest obstacles? And, or put it another way, what might be the easiest path towards getting these policies adopted in your view? I mean, even if it is a hard one, it would be interesting to know what you consider the easiest among the options. And then my second point is, you didn't say very much about China. And so given the increasing verbal belligerence of Canada vis-a-vis China, what do you think might be some of the implications for Canadian military actions in relation to China? And then the second question is, you did mention these soldiers who are in Palestine and so on. I wonder if you'd say something more about this recent situation in the Green Party, vis-a-vis Noah Zatzman and Annamae Paul and so on. And how do you interpret it, particularly vis-a-vis keeping political parties in line with the pro-NATO, pro-US, which also means you pro-Israel stance? So if you might give us your thoughts on that, that would be great.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Green Party thing is totally kind of off the wall. I don't know if you people saw that they, she just, Annamae Paul just named a new member of the shadow cabinet who refers to it as the BDS terrorists. A couple weeks ago, he just posted in Facebook group the BDS terrorists. So it's like Zatzman number two. And I looked at Pumch's name into Google, and back in 2016, when there was the resolution passed, he was all over attacking the resolution. I mean, I personally engage with the Green Party stuff. So I mean, I joined the Green Party to vote for Dmitry. I engage with the Green Party stuff. I follow it very closely because I think that it's a leverage point on the Palestine question. I think that there's two parts. There's just what Annamae Paul has done is just wildly autocratic and anti-democratic and whatever. She's clearly, you know, terrible on foreign policy across the board, right? Like she, just on Haiti thing, she tweeted out like, my condolences for this, the killing of Jovenel Moïse, which I, you know, in and of itself, I don't have a problem with at one level, but she's, you know, refused to say anything else about all of the killing that's happened in Haiti and all of Canada's policy in Haiti. She just met with the Latvian ambassador a couple days ago and says this pro-NATO thing, or at least according to the article, said that she talked about the good, the things that NATO does. And then she's clearly just fanatically anti-Palestinian. That's quite clear. But so I engage with it because I think that it's a real leverage point on the Palestinian issue. This is the Green Party and you know, most of the membership is clearly now pro-Palestinian at this point. And you can't let that clear of anti-Palestinian policy, can't let him get away with it, right? There has to be a cost, and I think it's really in play on that issue. There was in terms of the easiest campaign. I think one element, the backdoor attack against NATO around the government's refusal to sign the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons is one of a weak points. Like Elizabeth May, when she did her webinar on the UN Nuclear Ban Treaty with the Canadian Foreign Policy Institute and others, she said, she made a sort of coded thing that, like, if we can't sign the TPNW because of alliances, she didn't never mention NATO, because of alliances, then I think we should get out of those alliances. So that's an issue. And the UN nuclear ban treaty is, I also think it's quite, it's also a valuable issue to show the just incredible hypocrisy of the Trudeau, of Trudeau's foreign policy. We're all about international rules-based order, but we can't sign this treaty that, you know, most of the world support, most Canadians by large numbers, proportions support, and much of the world has backed in different forms. So that's it. I think that I can just say that there is this public letter around the fighter jets that has gotten that's being circulated right now, quite a number of very prominent people have signed on in the last couple of days. It's going to be released early next week, and kind of surprising how much pickup there's been. Interestingly enough, that both of the Green MPs have signed it. None of the NDP MPs have gotten back. That's interesting. Randall Garrison is the defense critic for the Green of the NDP, is really got a grip on that. We know that a number of the NDP MPs would like to sign that. I think that the back door or the soft underbelly on the fighter jet campaign is the climate crisis. And, you know, can we, in the context of this horror that happened in Lytton, BC, you know, 3 days of the highest temperatures ever, and then next day the whole town is wiped out, can we really be pumping money into something that's, you know, contributing to the climate crisis? And more importantly, those resources should be going towards making sure we don't have another Lytton disaster, right? That this is insane in this time that we're going to be locking ourselves into that when we should be locking, you know, pushing away in the other direction. So some of that, now that's kind of a rear guard. We're not actually defunding the military. We're just saying, no, don't buy new stuff, right? So that's not, you know, exactly where we want to be at, but, you know, reality is reality. With regards to China, I think that, you know, one of the back in 2011, the Globe or the Canadian Press story about the bases that Canada was setting up, the seven bases around the world, was one that was planned to be set up in Singapore. And if I remember correctly from Martin's article in The Breach a couple of days ago, I think he mentions it again, I'm not sure, but so it was explicitly about China, right? This was Obama's pivot towards Asia kind of stuff. And the Canadian military was following the pivot and wanting to set up a hub in the region to you know, engage with China. This is long before the arrest of Meng Wanzhou and all these other things, that, you know, Uyghur question and all whatever, all Hong Kong, whatever, right? This was the military planners were looking at this. The you know, Navy has been expanding the different missions in the region to pressure China, you know, the recent NATO summit, when, you know, explicitly mentions China and you know, the aggressiveness of Canadian officials on the question has gotten, you know, clearer and clearer, stronger and stronger. And also, I think that the military and the sort of security establishment have increasingly started to cite China as a justification for military spending, right? That's coming up more and more. So we have progressive-minded people who are like, we're concerned about the Uyghurs. And then, you know, we need to pump up the Canadian military is happening at the other end. And I think that there's some of the people who've gotten into the anti-China stuff are not seeing the full picture of this stuff and should think these things through, even if they come to the conclusion on, you know, this or that about internal Chinese politics, to be a bit cautious about how you lend support. It seems totally mad to think that the Canadian military would be, you know, planning for a war with China or anything like that. But you know, there's a lot in the history that suggests they're actually doing these kind of things. And the Korean War was in part, I mean, it was a war fought against China. It was, you know, the Chinese ultimately get brought in because the U.S. and Canadian forces are, you know, bombing right on the Chinese border, so, you know, we've already done that. You know, there was Canadian naval vessels in 49, right? The book Canadian Gunboat Diplomacy talks about the Canadian naval vessels sent just as the Mao's forces are winning, as part of, it's not exactly clear what they were doing. Were they trying to check, or possibly, you know, Mao's victory? Were they trying to just show the U.S. and British that we're, you know, strong allies? But that's certainly the China question looks like it's going to become a bigger and bigger part of Canadian militarism.
Paul, you're next.
Okay. Excellent presentation, Eve. I'm enjoying this very much. I wonder if you have any information on the status of Canada's participation in the Americans' program to weaponize space, and on a totally different but related topic, any thoughts about how difficult it might be to withdraw from NORAD and what the result might be if we were to do so?
Yeah, with regards to the militarizing space, there's clearly Canadian contribution, I think, through NORAD in part. The radar stat and radar stat 2, I think, contributes to that. The Canadian, I can't remember the details, but there is some Canadian contribution to U.S. Space Command, correct me on this, but I think is a relatively new command of the U.S. military. I don't have a whole lot more on that. With regards to NORAD, it's really not on the, even less than NATO. It's not on the agenda. I know that, you know, when the NDP passed that resolution in 69 for Canada out of NATO, the anti-war forces conceded on NORAD. At one point, I think they had both NATO and NORAD. It was, I don't know specifics, but they basically conceded on the NORAD. If I remember correctly, that at some point that was part of the maybe that was an actually earlier part of the NDP debate. No, I mean, yeah, NORAD's not, Canadian officials, Canadian military are still based in Colorado as part of NORAD. And my understanding is also that, NORAD systems are, it's all presented as defensive, but they're involved in the communications to enable the American invasion of Iraq, to enable in 2003, to enable bombing Libya. And there's Canadians that are, operating those systems. I believe in Tampa, Florida is where the base is, where much of that is going on. The idea of Canada as being under threat from a Russian invasion from the north or whatever has been a ridiculous idea all along and continues to be. But NORAD, I think, has been a big it's the preeminent of the Canadian military getting with the U.S. military, and I think that a lot of that's been framed as Canada conceding sovereignty to the U.S., which is, there's a heavy degree of truth to it. But I think the one element that I don't think is fully appreciated is, I think that from the Canadian military's perspective, it's a Canadian official who's number two at NORAD. So when the American official's not there, he's the top dog, right? And in charge of like incredible arsenal. Right. And so the Canadian, from the Canadian military's perspective, is like, we're actually contributing a small chunk to this, huge military empire, really. And we get to have these like, high positions within that empire. So the general critique of all this is from a sort of Canadian sovereignty element. And there's an important element there, but it's also important to look at it from the military's perspective of how sort of special of relationship they get with this well-armed force. But yeah, we should definitely, the anti-war movement should put that back on the agenda, and certainly bring it up at a minimum within Green Party or NDP and start that debate of Canada out of NORAD. And like NORAD, I think the Canadian government says it's like 500 different accords between the Canadian and American military, right? NORAD is just the most important one, but there's just hundreds and hundreds of these accords that link the two countries' militaries, arrangements, accords, and all those questions should be really, we should be raising those questions and challenging them.
Thank you, Yves. At this point, I don't see any more questions, and we are drawing to kind of Carl? Yes, Carl, you have a question, go ahead.
Okay, did I unmute? You can hear? Okay. First of all, I'd like to just say thank you to Yves for all the years and books and research and efforts that he has shared with all of us to keep holding light on these extremely dark events, topics, and issues. So thank you. I have a personal question. What propels you, what draws you, what stimulates and motivates you, Yves, to continue walking through this hellish area? A question I had relating, you can choose to respond to this or not, how the climate crisis is going to be affecting this ongoing militarization, which is basically about profit, whether it's the documentary Why We Fight, the fulfillment of Eisenhower's warnings, or Joel Bakken's new book, The New Corporation. Is it not about endless transfer of tax dollars into private pockets, and how to get organized. How can we fight this best? So those are three things that I share with you. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. My engagement with Canadian foreign policy begins in a serious way with the coup in Haiti in 2004, and being, you know, I'd been involved in different political activism, fighting the free trade area of the Americas and the, you know, anti-corporate globalization movement, but I sort of had the same kind of Canada is good, foreign policy, peacekeeping, whatever kind of ideas, and you know, seeing what happened in Haiti was just like, holy, whoa, right? You know, first you think it's, oh, they just kind of got confused, they got brought in by the Americans, not really knowing what they were doing, and then you just see, really, I mean, you have every element of the Canadian foreign policy, from the military to the police, to the diplomacy, to the aid agency, to the NGOs. All, you know, not making, like, you know, sort of a little bit on the wrong side, or, you know, doing something a little bit bad, but all of them basically just enabling such horror. And I was just really, I was just taken aback by that. And that sort of got me going on a whole process of looking into Canadian foreign policy. And if you can do that in Haiti, then what are you doing elsewhere? And unfortunately, you know, Haiti was an extreme example, but there's a lot of parallels to other instances in the world, and so, yeah, it's just been kind of a little bit my passion on to engage in that stuff, and I've obviously had the different you know, sort of all kinds of good fortune of being able to you know, live in downtown Montreal and have access to all these resources to look into these things and enabling all that kind of stuff. So that's with regards to the question about the, you know, profit motive and its role in all this. Yeah, I mean, that's a central part. I think that the military is, I think there's more, it's a bit more, the extent to which we're militarist is a bit more complicated. There's elements, I think, that are interesting about just, I think, hierarchy. The hierarchy of military is something that appeals to the capitalist class more broadly. Obviously, you know, racist, patriarchal nature of the military has been something that reinforces those dynamics. I think with regards to the climate crisis, and maybe I'm going a little bit off here, but I want to make this point because it angers me so much. You know, while watching the Montreal Canadiens get defeated in the Stanley Cup Finals, the thing more disappointing is the having to watch the truck ads on CBC. So here we are in 2021. We needed to move away from the private automobile as a mode of transport and living decades ago. We need to do that decades ago when we knew about the climate crisis and other ecological crises. In 2021, we are having ads, not for, like, the, you know, most fuel efficient cars, but the most gas guzzling, space guzzling, resource guzzling vehicles are being pumped at people watching the Stanley Cup finals. You know, if you need a truck for work, you'll get your truck for work. You don't need to be told you'll be a man by having this truck while you're watching hockey. And this is in 20, and there's no one even, like, this isn't even, is there even an environmental group that raises this issue? Is there, like, so here's the public broadcaster while, you know, Lytton, BC is, you know, wiped off the map and still pumping truck ads, and there's basically no social force that is, you know, even raising the issue of banning ads for cars on CBC, let alone truck ads. So, the profit motive and a primary explanation there, overwhelming explanation, is the profit motive and car companies wanting to sell cars there's a lot of battles that we need to be taking on. I think that the climate crisis is a central one, and the peace movement, where we can raising the role of militarism in the climate crisis is a really important part of winning public support, but also I think of contributing to fighting the climate crisis.
Thank you, Yves. We're just about at the time that we set for ending the webinar. I would just like to point out that one of the significant campaigns that's been launched in Canada by the peace movement has been the campaign against fighter jets. And Yves mentioned that. And we actually have on the webinar today, Rachel Small from World Beyond War. She's the Canadian organizer. So if you're interested, I mean, that is one campaign that is really, I think, gaining some traction. It may be still small, but it is gaining traction. And it's a campaign that deals with one very real element of these war preparations and this militarization in Canada. So just Rachel, in 1 or 2 minutes, would you just like to talk about the campaign?
Sure. Yeah. I put the link for the website at the bottom. It's not an exhaustive list of information, but it's sort of the elevator pitch. We meet monthly. It's really groups and individuals from really all across the country, lots of different types of groups. I think that we're just building steam now because this is the year that the decision's going to be made. And this is the year that we have to oppose it. So the time is getting tight. But also, I think our media moment is now. It's been very hard to get this on the public agenda while there's only sort of backroom discussions about which jet will be chosen. But I think the second there's an announcement, like, this campaign, I think, is going to really take off. So I guess that's my pitch. If people want to get involved, we do meet monthly. We're having a strategy meeting actually this Monday at 1 p.m. to sort of set our course for the next 3 months. But in general, people can plug in at any time. We're sort of planning on 7 different angles. You've mentioned sort of an open letter with really like notable and well-known folks in Canada endorsing the campaign. There separately are some sort of direct actions being planned when the campaign gets a little bit more timely. And then there's been a lot of behind the scenes digging as well. We've gotten a lot of questions put sort of on the order papers to get parliamentary answers on various things. We're doing some freedom of information requests, trying to do things on all cylinders, I guess.
Yes, very good. And as you pointed out in the chat, the 2 Green MPs have taken a stand against the fighter jets. And those are the ways things begin to change. Those small steps begin to change because I would note that on Eve's blog, I think it's your blog, you have a photo of a demonstration, and in it is the banner that says Canada needs an anti-war government. I think that's very appropriate. And that really begins to set the tone. And I would hope that during the what appears to be an election coming probably very soon, that various forces just try and put the agenda of these questions on the agenda in various ways. So I think that would be valuable. So if there's no further questions to Yves, because we are really at our time limit, that self-imposed time limit, just to keep it so that people can participate in other things today, I would like to thank Yves for his excellent presentation. I'd like to thank everybody who has been on the webinar, and hopefully we'll see you again at other webinars. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks.